Hi friends, in the last session on electrostatics, when we are discussing about capacitance, I just briefly about different types of capacitors depending on the shape. The most commonly used capacitor in many of the electrical appliances is what is known as parallel plate capacitor. Today in the current session, we shall try to find out the capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor. For this, I am just taking two conducting plates. These two conducting plates are very thin. Thin conducting plate is I am taking. And each has an area, let us say A. And I am just trying to separate them through a distance, say D, as per my convenience. And in between, I am just putting an insulating medium. Mean medium in between. In between plates is kept. Now this medium I am talking about can be an air, can be a paper, or something like a mica or something like a glass. Any of these insulating mediums I am using. I am trying to put them. So, let us do one thing. Let us look at a diagrammatic representation. I am taking a metallic plate. Let me call it as plate A, which is insulated. Now for this, you can call it as plate A. Okay, A is the area we have given, therefore let us call it as plate 1. And at a distance of D, let us say, I am keeping another plate 2. Now this distance of separation, I am calling as D. I am putting mica, air or glass or any other insulating medium in between. Okay, this is the arrangement. Now this we can call it as a capacitor. Because they are parallel to each other, we can call it as parallel plate capacitor. Now what I am trying for this is, let us say, I am giving a charge plus Q to plate 1. That means I am giving a plus charge to this plate uniform. So it gets distributed, as we know earlier, across the surface of the plate uniformly. So the moment you give positive charge to this, on the near end of this plate 2, what is near end? For plate 1, this is the near end. For plate 1 again, this side of plate 2 is the farther end. The moment you give positive charge to plate 1, immediately you will find an induced negative charge. So because of this positive charge given to plate 1, induced charge, opposite charge gets induced on the near side of plate 2 to plate 1. So that means the moment you give charge plus Q to plate 1, so that means charge minus Q is induced on the nearer face of plate 2, and because of this, a positive charge is automatically developed on the farther end. Remember, originally it was, there was no charge. This was only given positive charge. Because of the given positive charge, this charge tries to induce opposite charge on the near end of this plate. That is the setup. Got it? Now, because of this induced negative charge on this side of plate 2, on the other side of plate 2, the other side of plate 2 will be naturally become farther end for this. This is the nearer end, this is the farther end. Because of the induced negative charge developed in plate 2 in the near end, on the other side of plate 2, equivalent positive charge is developed. So this positive charge is farther end for this, this negative charge is nearer end to this. Only thing we have to remember is the accumulation of negative charge in the near end is due to the induction effect of this. Clear? And close this. Accumulation of positive side on the other side is because of the already induced negative charge here. That is the point we have to remember. So therefore, same thing I will write here. The moment you give charge Q to plate 1, charge minus Q is developed. That is this one. And because of this, near face of plate 2 and plus Q is developed on the farther end of plate 2. Now, having seen this, suppose you have earthed this. So, if plate 2 is earthed, the charge plus Q. Now, if you see, this is already insulated. Okay. Because of this, observe an interesting point here. This is already insulated, so this cannot go anywhere else. Because of this positive charge, this side negative charge is induced. These two are bounded, attracted to each other. So when this particular second plate is earthed, only thing that is free is positive charge. So this positive charge, because it is free, it gets drained quickly to the earth. So that is what am I trying to write here. If plate 2 is earthed, the charge plus Q being free flows to the earth. That means this entire positive charge gets drained. So how the picture looks like then is, you have plate 1 given positive charge. This gets distributed onto the other side uniformly, and this is insulated. Now at a distance of d, this distance you call it as d, you kept another plate 2. This charged positive will induce equivalent negative. Like this, and it is earthed. In this case, like the moment it is earthed, as I said earlier, this entire positive charge gets drained. So the picture looks like this now in the latest stage. After positive charge being free flows back to earth, This is how the capacitor structure looks like. Okay. Now here, plate 1 has a surface charge density. So I am using a term here called surface charge density. This is represented by the alphabet sigma. It can be positive or negative, plus or minus. It is nothing but the ratio between the charge Q here and the area. Area we have already taken in the description. Area as A. Q is the charge, A is the area, Q by A is sigma. If Q is positive, it is plus sigma. If Q is negative, it is minus sigma. So therefore, accordingly, we can write surface charge density of plate 1 is sigma, which is Q by A. Similarly, this is plus Q. Similarly, surface charge density of plate 2, sigma equal to minus Q by A. So you can write it as minus sigma. Okay. Now here, having understood the concept of surface charge density, we'll go for a small assumption in this description, and then based on that we will arrive at the expression for the capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor. Here two things are there. You have something called distance. Distance is what? The distance we are talking is a distance of separation, D. And then we are talking about area. Area or A is also known as linear dimension. Now here the case can be two things. D and A, if you see the relation between them, one may be less than the other, one may be greater than the other, one may be equal to other. One may be much greater than the other, one may be much less than the other. Like that. Different situations will come. So here, when we are talking about looking at the relation between distance of separation and the linear dimension of the plates, so the assumption we are making, therefore, the assume that distance between plates is much smaller than linear dimension of the plates. Linear dimension of the plates means area. D is much smaller than A. That means this condition helps us to arrive at D is much less than A. D is much less than means D square is also much less than A. So we can find resultant electric field. If you consider this assumption, resultant electric field due to the thin infinite parallel sheets can be calculated. So with the assumption that the distance between the parallel plates is much smaller than the linear density of the plates, then automatically we can use the resultant electric field due to two thin infinite parallel sheets of charge. What do you mean by that? If you see the capacitor picture, we are talking about distance, we are talking about area, we are not talking about length. That means the length of the sheet is immediately here. It is infinite, it can be infinitely long. So there is no restriction on the length. So these sheets are plates, you can call them as charged plates or charged sheets, infinitely long charged sheets. That is the idea we have to get. And that is the point when we write that electric field we can use between the two thin, infinitely parallel fields of charge, right? Interestingly, when we talk about electric field, the electric field we are talking about is inside or between the plates. So therefore, on the left of plate 1, on the right of plate 2, electric field is 0. Remember, when we are using the word electric field, we are talking about area and distance. So both together helps us to arrive at this region only. So electric field discussion is only belonging to this region. So therefore, when we look at electric field on the left of plate 1, on the right of plate 2, electric field is 0. That is what we are representing here. Therefore, in the regions on left of plate 1 and on right of plate 2, the electric field is 0. So therefore, we need to only consider the region between the plates only. So therefore, when we look at the region between the plates which are separated by air or vacuum as the medium. Now you can find electric field intensity between them. That means because the field on the left of plate 1, on the right of plate 2 being 0, the field only to be discussed is between the plates. So between these two fields which are separated by distance d and with a medium in between, we can calculate the electric field intensity between these plates as electric field intensity. That is what we call as E. This is nothing but surface charge density sigma by the dielectric constant epsilon. Already just now we have seen that sigma equal to Q by A. So therefore, when you look at these two equations, therefore E is equal to sigma by epsilon is equal to 1 by epsilon into sigma. Like that you can write. So this can be represented as E is equal to 1 by epsilon into sigma means Q by A. Right? Now this electric field we are talking about is the field between the plates. So therefore, between the plates, the electric field, we can say that it is localized. When the field is localized between the fields, between the plates, then it can be uniform throughout the plates. So if that field between the plates being localized and being uniform throughout, so we can calculate the potential difference between the fields. Potential difference we can calculate, it is nothing but the field into distance. So because the electric field we are considering is between the plates only, because outside this and outside this is found to be zero. So when we are calculating the electric field between the plates and we consider that as uniform, it is spread across the condenser or capacitor uniformly. So throughout the same field is there, that means it is localized. Therefore, we can calculate the potential difference as electric field times the distance of separation. That is the idea. So with that concept, we are taking the electric field localized between the two plates as uniform throughout the plates. Then what happens is the potential difference, what we normally use, that is nothing but voltage. Voltage between the plates, that is naturally E into D. That means electrical field times the distance between the plates. What does it mean? It does mean V is equal to E into D. Already just now we have seen E as 1 by epsilon times Q by A. So this E you substitute here, therefore V will become 1 by epsilon into Q by A into D. Why we are calculating potential? To calculate the potential, see, basic idea is very simple. Because what we are trying to find the capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor. So when we say parallel plate capacitance, C equal to Q by V, this you know very well. So we have to find C, for that we have to find V. To find V, you need to know E. Therefore, we already obtained E. So this E we will substitute here. So by substituting value of electric field in the potential equation, we will get potential. With this potential and charge, we will compute the capacitance. That is the basic idea. I hope you got it. So with this background, therefore, the capacitance C of a parallel plate capacitor is given by C is equal to Q by V. Now V is already as 1 by epsilon into Q by A into D, or QD by epsilon A. So we can substitute this here. Numerator is Q. V is what? V is Q divided by epsilon A. QD divided by, this is the expression we are using. To calculate this, E is QD by epsilon A. So denominator will again become QB, QD by epsilon A. Okay. Now these two get cancelled. Now this will come to numerator. So C will become epsilon A by D. This is the basic formula for capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor. Okay. Suppose if you introduce a dielectric medium between the plates. Earlier we are assuming that there is no dielectric medium, it's only either air or glass or mica, something like that I quoted. So it's a normal vacuum medium or air medium or glass medium you are using. Suppose you have introduced a dielectric medium between the plates, then automatically you have to use the relative permittivity. Relative permittivity, that is epsilon r, which is nothing but dielectric constant. its capacity can be capacity of the media. I'm not writing C, but I'm writing as C suffix M now. Earlier we wrote it as C. C naught also we can say, because if it is vacuum, you write C naught or C zero. Here I'm writing CM. That means capacity of a medium. Now this will become epsilon A by D, epsilon naught A by D. So you can write this as, well, two permeability, epsilon or epsilon naught A by D in the case of medium, but epsilon A by D is nothing but capacity at vacuum. Therefore, you can write capacity of the medium as epsilon or CO. For this, I wrote CO. Or you can write epsilon or K. K, C naught. You can write epsilon or K. So therefore, you can conclude that the capacitor of a parallel plate capacitor with a dielectric medium can be represented as CM is equal to K C naught. What is the C naught? It is the capacitance of the same parallel plate capacitor when medium is either air or vacuum. This is what is to be understood. Right? This is how you can arrive at the expression for the capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor with air and or vacuum as a medium, as well dielectric medium as a separation, as an insulating substance kept in between the parallel plates. This is the derivative part of parallel plate capacitor. Similarly, we can derive, though it is not part of your discussion, you can derive the expression for the capacitance of a spherical capacitor, the capacitance of a cylindrical capacitor also. I'll just give you, brief you briefly the formulae for problem solving situations. So this is what we have seen. With air or vacuum, you have capacitance formula like this. With a dielectric medium, you have formula coming like this. Both in the case of a parallel plate capacitor. Similarly, just remember these formulas. In the case of a, I'm putting as a note, in the case of a spherical capacitor, because it will be, it can be either hollow or solid, whatever it is, it will have an inner and outer radius. Therefore, the capacitance will be like this. C is equal to 4 pi epsilon naught Ra Rb by Rb minus Ra. So this Ra and Rb are radii. So inner as well as outer radii in the case of a spherical capacitor. Now this derivative part is not there for you. So if time permits, I'll explain you how to derive this formula also. As far as your board and university exams are concerned, this derivation is not important, but the formula is important. Similarly, if you take a cylindrical capacitor, it will also will have two radii, coaxial cylinders of same length. If you take, you have two radii, outer cylinder and inner cylinder concept. Outer and inner cylinder means a cylindrical concept will be like this now. So there will be an inner radius, there will be an outer radius. Similarly, in the case of a sphere, you will have something like a ring. So spherical, you have inner radius and outer radius. That's why you have Ra and Rb coming in the formula, radius of outer and radius of inner. Similarly, in the case of cylinder also, coaxially if you take, you will have two radius, two radii. So therefore, in the case of a cylindrical capacitor, the capacitance will be something like this. 2 pi epsilon naught length by logarithm of this Rb by Ra ratio, natural logarithm. In the case of a cylindrical conductor, cylindrical capacitor, the capacitance is 2 pi epsilon naught length by identical cylinders we take, inner and outer. Natural logarithm of ratio of the radii. This is the expression for cylindrical capacitor. This is the expression for spherical capacitor. These two formulae can be remembered from problem solving point of view. But the derivative part refers to these two only. So you will have Border University question asking you to obtain the expression for the capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor, because that is the standard capacitor. As I told you earlier, many of the electrical appliances we do use parallel plate capacitors. So therefore, this is the expression for parallel plate capacitor with air or vacuum as medium. This is the expression for capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor with a dielectric medium as the medium between the plates. In addition to these two, as a value addition, I am giving two more formulae with respect to capacitance of a spherical capacitor and cylindrical capacitors. So with this, we have successfully concluded electrostatics. I told you in the beginning of the very first lecture that we will discuss electrostatics from the angle of electric field, electric potential, electric flux, and capacitance. Right? Practice and get back with your notes if any. Right?